So you're saying that wood, as they do in the United States, is good to make mostly of wood? Is it a good thing to do, you say? You're saying?
Not sure it's a good thing, because for wood, there is some problem too. Because in Houston it happens, when it was flood, some of the houses was flooded and it was wood, but it was molded.
Yeah, it molds.
The water, yeah. So for that one, there is an inspection, mold inspection. After the each any of houses was flooded, it was inspection for mold. But I think maybe some of the owner from the high rising building, they didn't have inspection.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. That's one of those things about large and buildings and all those mm-hmm. things, right? When there are many people yeah. live there, and then the administration, if they really go to check, you never know, right?
Mm-hmm.
We right. never know that. That's right.
They think if they have a really strong building with a huge column of steel, it's good. It's good, but you need to have some inspection.
Is it like they you know, I don't know the technical terms, you know, sometimes they use like a beam of steel or iron, which is a complete beam or the mm-hmm. structure. And sometimes they use like I saw in some buildings, especially in Spain, I saw that very often, that there is a mixture of wire or metal rods with cement. Mm-hmm. Right, and then they make it.
They use this rod for a reinforcement.
Oh, it's just reinforcement.
To make it more strong.
Okay, even that needs and corrosion.
Actually, I think that one is good for earthquake too, because the steel can move. I think. You can transfer the vibration of air.
Okay.
So sometimes it's good. You know, it depends on the area. I think it's good to just have all these items to be checked, because it's important. Actually, as you said, you want to build this huge building at a desert, like Las Vegas, or it's in Florida. So a different environment, but they really like about the shape and how they look, but inside yeah. is important too.
And then what about that? Let's say cost of, you know, all these corrosion to human civilization, bridges are also the same, right?
Yes. Yeah. And actually we have collapse on the bridges.
Oh, we do.
Too. Yeah.
Could you elaborate on that, please? The problems with bridges?
I think it happens. I can't remember what was the exact time or a case, but I'm sure if we search, we have several things. For the bridge, I think also there's an inspection.
Otherwise.
They check it regularly after all these collapses happen, especially if it was a metallic one.
Yeah.
Totally built from the metal. So for those cases, I think they have some inspection.
Can we find a material which replaces iron, so we are not going to have this corrosion? But okay, everything rusts. I understand that. But
yeah,
can we find?
The cost is important. First of all, the cost is important. Steel is really I think it's cheaper rather than everything else, like for example copper or everything else, they still has some properties. It makes it different from others. You can shape the steel very well.
Yeah.
The steel is strong. For example, if you we want to compare a steel with aluminum is very light.
Yeah,
and it's not strong. So it can be deformed very well. Even we have a bridge with aluminum, it's super light, and with the wind can be floating, or with an impact, a strong impact can be destroyed. But we can use it, for example, in aerospace, aluminum is really useful. They use it everywhere in aerospace. Yeah. But for the structure and the huge building, I think the best thing we can use is steel, because of the price, because of the strength, hard ability, the shape, we can shape it, we can use it as a rod, we can use it as a beam. So,
Mahsa, what about titanium? We cannot use titanium, right?
No. It's so expensive.
Yeah. Very.
Yeah.
But lighter than steel, right?
I think yes, but I'm not sure they can shape it very well like a steel.
But very expensive, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the solution for avoiding rust and all this corrosion is still regular check and all these things, right?
Yeah, right.
And now I'm just trying to find, because, you know, you had a very good point. You said, like, you know, if you go to a, like, pipeline or like industrial sites, you go and check it and everyone listens. Now, if you go and find in a building, that in a, where people live, there is a problem and you cannot fix it. So then you need to have the whole building destroyed, right? And to build it new, correct?
If it's so corroded, yes. It depends on this, the remain life. Sometimes if there is the inspection tell us and all the risk assessment and all the evidence we have, we can see, we can say, for example, you have 5 years to the exact failure, or 3 years, or no, just right now it's too late, just go somewhere else. So it depends on the situation, is different, I think. But
I have a question for you. So how did our ancestors do? Look at in like Persepolis, look at the Egyptian pyramids, look at Aztec pyramids or Maya pyramids. I mean, they made everything out of stone and they lasted for so long, right?
Right. I can say some of them are miracle.
Really?
And I think they use it correctly. They use it, they design it correctly, they pick the material correctly, and they built it correctly.
Yeah, because, you know, it's again an area which really makes us think, or make me think, you know, it's just that we have all these new buildings and, you know, even in Europe, you know, we have cathedrals, they're so old, like centuries old, still standing, huge ones, right? And I always ask myself, what kind of material, and now after talking to you, I'm just thinking, what did they use that they last for such a long period of time?
Yeah, right. Exactly. It's really amazing. And maybe we can say they built so many things, but these are still there because they designed, they construction, and everything was perfect. Other one, it wasn't perfect, it was destroyed.
You know, for example, let's put it this way. Can you imagine the buildings we build today? Let's say I just take one of the cathedrals here close where I live. It's like 780 years. Could you imagine one of these buildings we built today would last 780 years like that? That huge one?
Yeah, I think maybe the main thing is right now we care about cost a lot. Those days, they don't. They didn't care about the people. Lives, they didn't care about the money.
So no, they didn't use that. It's very interesting to see these things and the costs, and so, because as you correctly mentioned it, you know, why wouldn't people check these buildings, these tall or large buildings? They don't. It's always a question of cost, right? You had it,
right.
very often the case. Also, you know, we had in Italy, I think it was in Italy a couple of years ago, where all those telecabins and all those for transportation on the app failed, and you know, some people died. And then they realized actually they did the checks, but not wholeheartedly, because they were trying to save costs again. You see, here we come back again at saving costs, but then these type of things can happen, which are extreme.
Exactly. This, most of the time is cost, and sometimes it's lack of information, because they don't know they want to spend this money on this purpose. They just say, okay, this is just the inspection, this is the regulation, this is blah, blah, blah. But if they don't, what happened exactly and what the actual cause is, the failure happened. It's not just the cost of that building itself. It's cost of some people lives and lots of things. And if they just think about it more, they can see, okay, this cost maybe is lot, it's a lot, but you know, if I do it today, it's better to do it later. The cost is lower today.
Like we have our cars regularly checked. I mean, that, right?
Exactly, right. Even, if something happened to your car and you stop in the highway. Yep.
All right.
Exactly. Same thing.
It's very, very, very interesting what you mentioned. So the only solution to this is that regular check by experts who come to the building and see what's going on, right? Is there like a rule how often they should be checked?
I think it's after something happened, like an earthquake, like a flood, and some this major thing, for sure we need to have it. Yeah. And depends on the maybe the construction company, the designer company is different, and the year they built, it was built. I think in the recently we have more regulation and everything is updated. So if we say, for example, this is good for 20 years, if nothing major happened, maybe it's good for 20 years. But we are not sure about the old days. There wasn't any regulation, there wasn't any standard those days. So it's good to have it for old building, at least one time during all this design life, to make sure it's good. Just keep working on that structure working.
That's right. So once you go to a building to check, you just take some samples from here and there, right? You don't need to check everything in the building, right?
For the corrosion wise, we just need to check what is the metallic part.
Okay,
the metallic. Not everything. For example, if the mold inspector come to the house, they just check for mold, not for everything. So I think it's really important to have this specific inspector, certified engineer, I mean, for the metallic structure. Maybe there is some other parts need to be inspected, but this is for other people. For example, they have like a HVAC inspector or different inspector, but it's good to have a specific person just for the metallic parts.
What other costs can you just mention regarding cost of corrosion to human civilizations? We talked about buildings, we talked about bridges, we talked about pipelines, you know, what else can we think about that?
Lives, because everything is happens, they can cause to kill other people. So yeah, it's affect on everybody's lives even. But in the industry, what can I say? I can say for anything we have metallic things, we need to have this, at least we need to think how many years we use this. And it's really important to maintain the metallic things very well. If it, for example, it's hidden, it's in a hidden part, like this reinforcement in the building, for sure, I'm as a person living in this house, I may not know about these details, but the company owned this building, or the person have a drawing, or a person buy the house, they should think about this more. About the other structure, I can say, maybe any workshop or any storage place. What else?
What about trains, planes? They need, of course.
Oh, the rails. The rails.
The rails, yes.
Yes, the rails.
Absolutely.
And it, what happened for the rails and the pipeline, the design maybe is really good design. And for example, it's for 25 years. And then they add some other structure to it. For example, they try to have electricity to other places. So they have lots of poles with lots of high voltage power close to the, for example, train rail. So the electric company, maybe they doesn't care, okay, I just need to add some poles here. I don't touch anything else, but there is a pipeline close to it. And these AC, high voltage AC affected on the, for the corrosion, because it caused induced current to the earth, and this induced current, it caused electron movement in the electrolyte in the soil. Oh. So it caused corrosion. So it's really important to just to be checked every at least few years to just make sure there is nothing new. If there is something new, what is the impact on our structure or whatever we have as a metallic structure? And if we want to have something new, they should know about the other structure close to it. So now for a pipeline and all the power line, this is something under regulation. But lots of things happened before to be regulated now, these days. So these days is really routine and everybody knows about it, but 100 years ago, and they just start to have electricity everywhere. They didn't know it's affected to the, for example, train rail, or doesn't affect it to the pipeline is going somewhere. So these costs we already paid. That's why we have regulation these days. So this thing happened to this to the Florida building. I think it's really sad. And if we want to not happen again, we need to have other regulation.
So is it like United States started to have some regulations after this this sad event in Florida? Did they
I'm not sure they start working on it, but for sure should be, because it happens. This is not the first building this collapse happened, and for other building it happens few years ago, 50 years ago, 20 years ago. So this is a major thing, and we need to think about it more.
That's right. Yeah, of course, something sad happens, and then first voices are raised if we need something to be regulated, and then the regulations come and then they're enforced. And then if someone does not follow the regulations, he or she or they will be punished then, right? That's the whole
procedure. Right. Yeah, exactly. True. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, very, very interesting. Very interesting. Thank you very much, Mahsa John. Do you want to add anything else to our topic today?
I just like to say something about the sword. Do you have your own sword, right?
Yeah, we do.
How you maintain it? Yeah, how you maintain it? How you keep it clean and...
For swords, it depends. It depends. You know, for example... Okay, are you talking about, you know, like museums or antiques, or are we talking about newly made swords for training?
Both of them. I think for the antique team, they just try to not touch to it, just keep it as is.
I mean, let me different cultures have different understanding. You know, for example, if you go to Nihonto, which is the Japanese blade, right, from Japan. Nihonto is where they fold this folding process. They take it from tamahogone, which is like iron ores. So they fold it. I mean, it's a very long process, and then they make the blade, right? To make the blade in Japanese tradition, the only place you can go and learn, I know some people hate that when they hear it, is Japan. So normally you need to go to Japan, you learn it 4 to 5 years, and then you're going to be certified to make such a sword. In Japan, it is regulated. For example, in Japan, you cannot make any other type of sword. You need to only work traditional, and then you can make it. And then you're allowed only to make like one or two per month or something like that. I don't know, top of my head. And the lengths, it's all determined, because then the government doesn't want the rest of things which are don't follow the tradition to be produced, right? But then sword making, excuse me that I'm mentioning this, after all these things done, swordsmith is a different profession in Japan. Sword polisher is another profession. And what does sword polisher do or did? After this, you know, they have like say 80 to 100, sometimes 120 natural stones from hard to soft. So they start to polish it by water and by hand, by these stones. So they put it, and then they try to bring the activity which the smith created during forging process to reveal it. So the revelation in the Japanese blade is like, say, this folded steel, which they did for so long, is like a painting. Some of them is like in Japanese, omidare. Right, it's like the waves of the sea. Some of them, and they have beautiful name, mountain, shoji, and cloth, and all these things. So they bring it. So the whole idea, once the blade is polished, you are not allowed to touch it anymore. It's extremely sharp, and any touch of the hand of this acid we have will eat into the polish. It will remain there. And if it eats into the polish, the sword needs to be sent to Japan, and a sword polisher needs to polish it, which costs, again, a lot of money.
Oh, I see.
Okay? So what they do, I mean, if you go with antiques, I mean, if you're a real proper collector, because there are some rich people who can collect these type of things, and we as researchers rely on them, right? So then they have a shoji oil. Shoji oil, it's called, if you want to translate from Japanese, shoji means clove oil. But it's actually not a direct clove oil. It's a specific oil which has a bit of clove scent. Like, you know, we say mihak in Persian in it. So it smells like that. But they put it on it. And then it's a very expensive oil and a very good one. So once you have shoji, depending how long, then you need to, after like a couple of months, and they are in a, you know, closed area, and they come and wipe it off, they put another shoji oil on it. And once they go get close to the blade, they have, like in COVID era, you need to put a mask here, and you need to put gloves and then touch it, right? And everything is super clean. Now, We treat Japanese blades like that. And then people who watched movies think these things were meant for, you know what I mean? And now they're treating them like Picasso paintings.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. That's what I was thinking.
Yeah. And this is actually, it doesn't mean that they're not weapons. They are weapons, but they're also at the same time pieces of art. In our tradition, like in Pulad Gohardar or Johardar, like Safavi tradition, this was the same thing. They put oil, you shouldn't touch it, because they considered it, in Safavid period, for example, we have it in our Persian manuscripts, a sin to touch a blade with bare hand. So they always need to oil. The reason is because our acid in our fingers eat into the blade,
mm-hmm.
right? And then you will see, you know, sometimes you see that. You see that, you know, when we go, okay, good collectors don't, but sometimes when we go to some, you know, sometimes, how can I put it? Some people have collections, but
okay.
they have money, but they touch, unfortunately, the blades, right? And they don't realize it. Sometimes it doesn't need to be visible by, you know, bare eyes, because, you know, we have also, you know, special glasses or, you know, magnifiers. Oh, and then okay. we can see the, you know, digital fingerprint. Yeah. And then we said, okay, these are going to eat into your blade. And then they are so shocked. What? And then, you know, I don't know, you know, for that. So if you want to play, you know, do all these things, we do it as well. As you know, we train, but they're all newly made swords. So if a newly made sword has my, you know, fingers on it and eats to it, who cares? It's not an expensive thing. It's not a natural heritage. You know what I mean? It's just a piece of steel newly made. And actually, even there, I cannot touch them. And people always laugh at me, you know, because after each training, I clean it. Although there is no reason to do that because it's not an antique, but I'm just, because of you respect.
You used to treat everything like antique.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's just, you know, because it's, one thing is a question of price, but another thing is a question of national and cultural heritage. Because, you know, that's what we always do. You're not owner of these antiques. You're custodian. You know, because we look at it like CSR. We look at it like, you know, sustainability. You're a custodian of them. And then you inherit it to the next generation. And, you know, and it, in my opinion, it is extreme. And that's why, you know, in Iran, nowadays they are thinking about it, pass a law. I mean, I read about that, that private collections also of antiques, because antiques, like in Islamic era, as they say in Iran, is allowed, but not if you go back, as they call it, because of illegal excavations. But one thing they realized, and they, I think Iranian museums need to learn from European, Russian, and American, we need to stop illegal excavations. We need to stop, but we need to also understand one thing,
mm-hmm.
important things. A, museums do not have the capacity, place, and the money to keep all antiques. You know, they cannot do that. So that's why we need an exchange between collectors and museums, so all of them in a community to work together, and researchers, right, mm-hmm. to do that. And for that, you know, taking care of antique swords, arms and armor, antique ones with oil, and, you know, if you want to do it, I can tell you one thing. You need to buy good oil, you need to take care of it, and it is an expensive hobby. It is an expensive hobby just to take care of it, right? And then when something is, you know, out of oil, antiques, and then you need to have someone who knows how to polish, how to take care of it. And sometimes, you know, some collectors who have the means financially.
So you need to be trained, and you need to have it to regular maintenance.
Yes, regularly. Otherwise, you're going to lose it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Even if you don't see it, you know, and as you said it very, that's why I'm really interested in what you do, because, you know, because these damned corrosion, you know, that's what we try to fight against it in swords, right? So always hate these things, right?
Yeah, it's so true.
You know, and also, you know, you see that, you know, we have steel armor, you know, and this newly made armor, we fight with it and steel, they look beautiful. What people don't realize is steel armor can cost like a car because they're handmade, you know, and then we put it on. And now people although it's not an antique, right? But, you know, if you pay so much money to have an armor, you need to take care of it, maintain it, right? So people don't maintain it. They just put oil from outside, but they don't realize inside it's rusting. Why is it rusting?
Yeah.
Excuse me, as human being, if I put it on, okay, I have a clothes and gambas on, but still I sweat, and this is acid, and it goes into the armor. And then after a while, you know, I remember a guy wanted to fight and said, oh, you're having pitting. And once you have a pitting on your armor, they don't allow you to fight, because if the pitting is too much, the metal structure could fail during fights, right? Of course. As you know, better than I do. So, you know, that's why these damned pitting, these damned rusting, you know, I just, you know, terrible thing. I mean, that's your ass. So that's what we try to do, you know. And then what you said, you know, after you kindly mentioned that, you know, actually many collectors watched what you said. Exactly.
Actually, I want to add, the corrosion is the fact. Every time it's happened, we just try to stop it and reduce it. So even if you don't have any inspection or maintenance or whatever, if you don't see corrosion, you should ask why there is no corrosion here.
Because it's still there.
Because it's a fact. It should happen. Every time it's happened. Always it's happened. Whenever you have a steel, you should have rust. This is the facts in a nature. So with all engineering, we try to just reduce the corrosion rate. So if for example, you just don't touch it for several years and it was in a wet area, there wasn't any oil. So if you just see the sword, you should expect it to be rusted, right? This is a fact. Every time it's happened.
That's right. I mean, crucible steel blades, you know, many of them, I was also talking to many, you know, there was a claim that, oh, there was some sort of like stainless steel, which is absolutely not correct. You know, everyone who is into steel analysis and crucible steel at museums know they rust constantly. And even as we talked about it last time, even the, like from Sheffield era, like in England, even today, even stainless steel rusts. We know that, right? We know it rusts. You know, like in the kitchen, our kitchen, you know, sometimes when a knife or when a spoon or when a fork breaks, and the handle goes away, then you see in the tang area rust on the stainless steel. And then you ask yourself, why did it rust? I thought it was stainless steel, but it rusts, right?
Yeah, it's slower, but it happens.
It happens, right? Exactly. Yeah. Lower, but it happens. So you can never, ever completely stop it, right? What if you have, just the last question, what if you put it in a, like in a, vacuum, there is no air in it. Would it still rust?
No, I think in a space you don't have corrosion. You can transfer it to the Mars or Moon.
Then there is no corrosion. Okay, no air, no corrosion. That's a good point to know for future generations, right?
Yeah.
Or we can create somewhere possibly that there is no air, right?
Yeah, but every structure we want to have it, like a building, like a pipeline, there is, I think there's no place to have it vacuum.
No, you're
we
right.
Can do it, yeah, it's a...
No, you can't.
If we just try to have something different, yes, we can.
Absolutely. Thank you very, very much for your wonderful contribution, Mahsa.
Thank
as usual,
you. My
I
pleasure.
Learned a lot and very informative. Really, really, thank you very much. And
thank you for your time, for your invitation. Thank you.
Thank you. And I wish you a nice day. Thanks.
Thank you. You too.